University, New Delhi. His talk on in silico analysis, computational techniques in target identifications. Dr. Uma Bhandari is faculty of pharmacy, Jamia Hamdard University, New Delhi. She has research experience in various capacities in Jamia Hamdard
Hello. Sir, voice is not coming.
2018 organized by International Atherosclerosis Society at Toronto in June 2018, second international conference on obesity and chronic disease at San Francisco, USA in July 2017, second world congress on targeting microbiota Paris, France in year of 2014, 81 European Society Congress, Lyon, France in June 2013, Gordon Research Conference on Leprotein, Lipoprotein Metabolism, World Congress of Pharmacology 2002 and China in year of 2006. She is a member of various Environment and Government of India, European Atherosclerosis Society members, Obesity Society USA, Member American Diabetes Association USA, Live Member India Society of Pharmacovigilance, Live Member India Society of Heart Research, Live Members India Society of. She has published more than of 75 publications in various journals. She has completed various research projects by UGC, AICT, CCRAS, Department of AYUSH, Ministry of Health and Government of India. She is empaneled as an expert in UPSC since year of 2016. She is a member of Project Reviewer Committee of ICMR. Certificate of Excellence, travel grants,
सर वॉइस नहीं आ रही है.
हेलो मैम, यू आर ऑडिबल.
आई एम ऑडिबल. ओके सर.
यस मैम. यस मैम.
ओके ओके.
Share your screen.
Okay, okay, sir. I'm sharing yes. my screen.
Yes, yes ma'am.
Yeah. Sir, this is visible, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Visible.
Okay. So I'm making it a full screen, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And here. Yeah. A very good afternoon to all. Today I am
good
going
afternoon,
to
ma'am. Afternoon.
Good afternoon, and thank you Dr. Kushwaha and Dr. Monica for inviting me for the talk. I am Dr. Uma Bhandari, and I am going to speak on in silico analysis, the computational technique in target identification. Before I start my topic, I'll say a few introductory words for my topic. Drug discovery, it is an important process. Until the end of the 19th century, the useful life of a drug was considered to be of 30 to 50 years. But by the end of 20th century, it came down to one or two decades. This has resulted because of the strict regulations governing the development of new drugs that have evolved over the last three decades to assure their safety and efficacy. So this is an era of personalized medicine. As you have seen, personalized medicine, or we can call it as a precision medicine. So this is a term which is used for the treatment, focusing on the patients based on their individual clinical characterization, considering the diversity of symptoms, severity, and genetic traits. So it is a personalized medicine, a new approach, which is based on the patient's unique genetic makeup. Now, to build this system, personalized medicine system, molecular characterization of disease is necessary, while environmental influences and gut microbiota needs to be also considered. At the same time, regulatory requirements safety are increasing. Now, this is a drug discovery. Just a minute, please. Okay. And in this, I want to tell you about the gut microbiome also. So gut microbiota, because if you say you need to make a molecular characterization of the disease, but there are environmental influences and the gut microbiota needs to also be considered. So this gut microbiome, it is defined by the molecular biologist Lidlberg into, this is, means a collective collectivity of all microorganisms, whether it is bacteria, whether it is virus, whether it is protozoa or fungi, and their collective genetic material present in the GIT or gastrointestinal tract. So the gut microbiota is composed of all the bacteria, and commensal bacteria as well as the pathogenic bacteria which is residing in the GIT. So gut microbiota plays an important role in nutrient and mineral absorption, synthesis of enzymes, vitamin and amino acids, and the production of short chain fatty acids. So gut microbiota plays an important role in both maintenance of health and the pathophysiology of disease. Now, the recent studies have revealed a close relationship between the inflammatory and the metabolic pathways. And the inflammation is now recognized to have a major role in obesity and the metabolic disease, such as insulin resistance and the atherosclerosis. So these bacteria have long known to activate the inflammatory pathways. So recent data demonstrate that gut microbiota plays may affect the lipid metabolism. So they may have a role in the atherosclerosis production, in the obesity production, and number of other cardiovascular disorders. Now, the environmental influence, as I told you, the environmental influences or effect of this also to be considered. So the expression of gene in an organism can be influenced by the environment, including the external world in which the organism is located or develops, or as well as the organism. Internal world, which includes such factors as hormones and metabolism. So one major internal environment influence that affect gene expression is gender, as in the case with sex influence or sex-limited traits. Similarly, drugs, chemicals, temperature, and light are among the external environment factors, and that can determine which gene are tuned on and off, thereby influencing the way an organism develops and functions. Now, drug discovery and development timeline. Now, drug discovery is a and the drug development process is a three-step process, three main phases. So first is a drug discovery phase, then preclinical phase and the clinical phase. So drug discovery means during which the candidate molecules are chosen on the basis of their pharmacological property. Preclinical, the drugs during the period during which a wide range of the animal studies are performed, for example, pharmacokinetic, pharmacodynamic, and the toxicity studies. And third is the clinical trial phase. So during which the lead compound is evaluated for the efficacy, for the safety and adverse effect in human volunteers and the patients. So generally, this we have taken the 10,000 compounds in drug discovery phase, and 250 compounds has come ultimately at the preclinical stage, and only the 5 compounds in the clinical trials. So this much time went, 6.5 years up to this phase, 7 years up to this phase, and the FDA review 1.5 years. So one FDA drug comes after so much of years, you have to total down this after 10 to 15 years, after 7, 16, 15, 20 years. So a typical development time is estimated to be 10 to 15 years. Now, the drug discovery, just a minute because I'm not able to see this, a drug discovery process involves the identification of the lead structure, followed by the synthesis of its analog and their screening to get candidate molecules for drug development. What is the goal of drug discovery? Is to search for new drug molecules which can bind to a specific target known to be involved in causing a disease and change the target's function. So in the traditional drug discovery process, identification of a suitable drug target is the first and the foremost task. So these targets, what are these targets? They are the biomolecules, which mainly include DNA, RNA, and proteins like receptors, transporters, enzymes, and the ion channels. So validation of these targets is necessary to exhibit a sufficient level of confidence and to know their pharmacological relevance to the disease under investigation. Now, this can be performed from very basic level, such as cellular, molecular level to the whole animal level. So once the target validation has performed, effective compounds such as inhibitors, modulators, or antagonists for such target needs to be identified. So this process is called as lead identification, where the design and development of a suitable assay is done to monitor the effect of target under study. Now, there is high throughput screening. It plays a crucial role in this phase, where large number of chemical compounds are exposed to the target compounds, to the target and compound showing dose-dependent target modulation in terms of a certain degree of confidence are processed further as leased compounds. So the last two decades has seen the astonishing innovation in technology that have helped the manual low-speed screening to evolve into an automated microprocessor control robotic process called as high throughput screening, HTS. So this recent process is the synergy of chemistry, synergy of biology, engineering, and the informatics. So we get high throughput screening. So initially, we used to get 50,000 to 10,000 compounds were screened per week. But now there are advancements have been made. So it is possible to screen up to 10 lakhs compounds within 24 hours. So this process is called the ultra high throughput screening. So large number of test compounds in a lesser time is a reality now. So high throughput screening plays a crucial role in this phase. Subsequently, the experiments are performed on the animal models in the laboratories, and the positive results are then optimized in terms of potency and the selectivity. Then physicochemical properties and then their pharmacokinetic and safety features are also assessed before they become candidates for the drug development. Even though most of the processes depend on experimental tasks, in silico approaches are playing important role in every stage of drug discovery process. Now, the What is in silico? In silico, it is an expression used to mean performed on computer or via computer simulation. So the expression in silico was first used in public in 1989 in the workshop Cellular Automata Theory and Applications in law in New Mexico, USA. Now, this way. Now, this scientist, a mathematician, Mira Montes from the National Autonomous University of Mexico presented a paper or report on DNA and RNA physicochemical constraints, cellular automata and molecular evolution. In his talk, Mira Montes used the term in silico to characterize the biological experiments carried out entirely in a computer. Now, although in silico studies represented a relatively new avenue of inquiry, it has begun to be used widely in studies which predict how drugs interact with the body and with pathogens. So in silico techniques significantly contribute to early drug discovery, and they are important in target and lead discovery. Now, in silico means modern, it's a modern word. It means experimentation which is performed by the computer and is related to the some commonly, more commonly known as in biological terms, in vivo and in vitro. So it is related to the biological terms in vivo and in vitro, but this is performed on the computer. So this in silico pharmacology also, and the name of this is computational therapeutics and computational pharmacology. So it is a rapidly growing area that globally covers the development of techniques for using software to capture, to analyze and integrate biological and medical data from many disease sources. So specifically, it defines the use of this information in the creation of computational models or simulations that can be used to make predictions and suggest hypotheses and ultimately provide discoveries or advances in medicine and therapeutics. Now, this is in silico drug discovery process. So target identification, and next step is the hit identification, hit to lead, and then ultimately lead optimization. Then we have to go for clinical trials, and the clinical trials, and then regulatory approval in the market, for the market. Now, what are the steps involved in the process of drug discovery? So first is the lead identification. So critical factor, first lead identification, it is a critical factor in the search for lead structures. So leads can be obtained from natural products, structure directed molecular designs, and modification of the natural products, biochemical understanding of disease process, and broad screening of the synthetic compounds. Now, second step in the drug discovery process is the lead optimization. So it involves the identification of the lead molecule through the synthesis and testing of the derivatives of the leads to develop structure-activity relationships, calculation of physicochemical properties, and using them for lead refinement from techniques like quantitative structure-activity relationship. Now, modern techniques such as combinatorial chemistry coupled with high throughput screening provide us an enormous number of new chemical entities. But these techniques have not been proved cost effective due to high cost of reagents in addition to the involvement of costly modern equipments. Hence, there is a strong demand for computer assisted techniques which are fast, reliable and cheap to rationalize these early steps in drug development. Please wait. Now, then after lead optimization, next step is, as I told in the diagrammatically, preclinical lead development. So drug formulation experiments, in vivo study in animals, animal safety studies, drug metabolism studies, and large-scale synthesis come under the umbrella of preclinical lead development. Now, then the clinical lead development, it involves small-scale safety and dose ranging tests in healthy human volunteers, that is phase one, and development of clinical study protocol employing clinical investigation on patients, phase two, and lastly, comparative double-blind studies on patient studies, that is phase three. Then several sequence and structure-based approaches have been proposed for target identification. So in the sequence-based method, functional information about the target and its positioning in the biological network is provided to detect the unique targets from the disease-causing pathogens by comparing functional genomics of human with corresponding genomics of pathogens. Now, the general methodology followed for finding a novel target specific for a given disorder involves random high-throughput screening. So in this process, large chemical libraries are checked for their capacity to block and or modify the target. For instance, if the target is a novel beta-lactamase enzyme, okay, compounds will be screened for their ability to enhance or reduce the activity of that receptor altogether, block it. In this manner, novel pharmacophores are being discovered at a significant pace nowadays. Furthermore, an important aspect of such screening is that the selectivity of compounds for the target is also deduced by concurrently screening the hits against other targets. This is called as a cross screening. The significance of cross screening is that if the compound hits frequently at non-related target, it is expected to cause significant toxicity in the human body. Okay, as when the drug reaches to the stage of human clinical trials. Now, at this juncture, it is noteworthy to mention about another screening method referred to as virtual high throughput screening. In this type of screening method, computer-generated models are used. These computer programs attempt to dock virtual libraries consisting of 3D structure of chemicals to a target. So this method is quick and economical also. Through these methods, the scientists discover a lead molecule series. The chemical structure included in this series are expected to possess adequate target specificity and favorable properties for drug likeness. Following this, one or two compounds may then be selected for the drug development. So best compound of these is termed as lead compound. And the lead compound is further optimized by random trials or more judiciously rational drug design methods. So a major target in drug discovery process is to develop a high degree of rationality. So this would represent an intellectually rigorous approach incorporating the computer-assisted molecular design, limited but highly focused chemical synthetic effort, and sophisticated biological assays. Thus, the drug design process may become significantly less risky and more resource efficient. Now, these leads are then examined for whether these compounds share some common features. Chemist and modeler then use structure SAR to improve the certain structural features of the lead molecules. Why? To increase the activity against the chosen target, to reduce the activity against the unrelated targets, and to improve the drug-like or absorption distribution or pharmacokinetic property of the molecule. The rational drug design approaches are maturing in the sense that they are moving from being only a theoretical promise based on their use in the retrospective analysis of the known compounds to innovative design and discovery of novel chemical entities and providing solution to novel problems. So there are a number of successful examples in the literature using the rational design approaches for design and discovery of the novel chemical entities. So the advances in computer hardware and software have made this process more effective and time efficient. So in silico analysis or techniques, significantly contribute to early drug discovery, and they are important in target and the lead discovery. So it can be anticipated that contribution of in silico techniques in drug discovery will increase substantially in the future. And use of in silico methods will need to become part of every researcher involved in discovery ultimately. Now, drug design. Drug design is an inventive process of finding new medication based on the knowledge of a biological target. It involves the design of molecules that are complementary in shape and charge to the biomolecular target with which they interact and therefore will bind to it. This is the life cycle of a drug design. There are three steps: synthetic or natural compound, preclinical trial, and clinical trials, and then finally drug. But in the modern drug discovery process is different. So it is a natural ligands, first screen, then molecular biology, protein chemistry, then 3D structure determination, and there's a modeling, the target and target ligand complex modeling, and then drug design cycle, then the structure analysis and compound design, biological testing, and then structure analysis and computer design. If all these gives a problem, then there is a synthesis of compounds, new compounds, and then again they go for biological testing. If this results are promising, then they go for the preclinical trial as compared to the traditional life cycle of a drug design. Now, computer-aided drug design. So this represents the computational methods and resources that are used to facilitate the design and discovery of the new therapeutic solutions. Now, what are the objectives of this CAAD? First, to change from random screening against disease assays, natural products, and synthetic chemicals to change from this to rational drug design and testing, speed up screening process and efficient screening, de novo design, integration of testing into design process, and fail drug fast. So remove the hopeless ones as early as possible. So these are the computer-aided drug design objectives. Now, drug design with the help of computer may be used at any of the following stages of drug discovery: either hit identification using virtual screening, hit to lead optimization of affinity and selectivity, then lead optimization, finally, optimization of other pharmaceutical properties while maintaining the affinity. Now, selected design molecule should be organic molecule, complementary in shape to the target molecule, and oppositely charged to the biomolecular target. Now, this molecule will interact with the target, bind to the target, and activates or inhibits the function of a biomolecule such as protein. Now, there are two types of drug design: ligand-based drug design and structure-based drug design. First is the ligand-based drug design. It relies on the knowledge of other molecules that bind to the biological target of interest. It is used to derive a pharmacophore model that defines the minimal necessary structural characteristics a molecule must possess in order to bind to the target. A model of biological target may be built based on the knowledge of what binds to it. And this model in turn may be used to design new molecular entities that interact with the target. Or alternatively, a quantitative structure-activity relationship in which a correlation between calculated properties of molecules and their experimentally determined biological activity may be derived. These QSIR relationship in turn may be used to predict the activity of the new analogs. Now, structure-based drug design. If you rely on the knowledge of the three-dimensional structure of biological target, which is obtained through X-ray crystallography, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, then target structure, a target 3D structure is required, then protein data bank, PDB, required X-ray diffraction, NMR, and homology modeling is required. If an experimental structure of a target is not available, then it may be possible to create a homology model of the target based on the experimental structure of a related protein. Homology modeling, also known as a comparative modeling of the protein, it refers to constructing an atomic resolution model of the target and experimental three-dimensional structure of a related homologous protein, that is the template. So, using the structure of the biological target, candidate drugs that are predicted to bind with high affinity and selectively to the target may be designed using either interactive graphics and then using the intelligence of a medicinal chemist and various automated computational procedures which may be used to suggest the new drug candidates. Now, what are the methods? First is virtual screening. You have to identify new ligands for a given receptor by searching the large database of 3D structures of small molecules to find those fitting the binding pocket of the receptor using fast approximate docking programs. Then second step is the de novo design of the new ligands. In this what happens in this method, the ligand molecules are built up within the constraints of the binding pocket by assembling small pieces in a stepwise manner. And these pieces can be either individual atoms or molecular fragments. And the key advantage of such a method is that novel structure can be suggested. The third is optimization of the known ligands by evaluating the proposed analogs within the binding cavity. Now, molecular docking. So in this, molecular docking approach can be used to model the interaction between a small molecule and a protein at the atomic level, and which allows us to characterize the behavior of the small molecule in the binding site of the target proteins, as well as to elucidate the fundamental biochemical processes. So there are two steps basic in the docking process: prediction of the ligand, conformation, as well as the position of its position and orientation within these sites. So this is referred to as POSE, an assessment of the binding affinity. Now, these two steps are related to sampling methods and scoring schemes respectively. Binding site identification. The first step in the structure-based design so relies on the identification of the concave surface on the protein that can accommodate drug-sized molecule. That also possess appropriate hot spots, that is called as the hydrophobic surfaces, hydrogen bonding sites, etc., that drive ligand binding. Then docking and scoring. Docking, what the docking does, it attempts to find the best matching between the two molecules. So right key for the lock. To place a small molecule or ligand into a binding site of a receptor, in the manner appropriate for the optimal interaction with the receptor, and to evaluate the ligand-receptor interaction in a way that may discriminate the experimentally observed mode from others and estimate the binding affinity. This is a molecular docking. Target plus ligand, molecular docking. So right key for the lock. Now, what are the components of docking? Pre and or during locking, representation of receptor binding site and the ligand. During docking, sampling of configuration space of the ligand receptor complex. And third, during docking and scoring, evaluation of the ligand receptor interaction. So computer-aided drug design, time, cost, accuracy, information about the disease and screening is also reduced, and database screening, less manpower is required. So it is less time consuming. Now, the following slide shows the success stories of the computer-aided drug design. So in our lab, our PhD students perform the in silico study with the help of a pharmaceutical chemist. They had a that software, so we took the help of that. So we use protein-protein docking of anti-PCSK9 monoclonal antibody one and the standard ligand atorvastatin against the toll-like receptor 2. Now this anti-PCSK9, the full name of this PCSK9 is the pro-protein convertase subtilisin oblicaxin type 9 monoclonal antibody 1. Monoclonal antibody. This is discovered as an emerging therapy in the development of new cholesterol lowering agent for the dyslipidemia. So even this is more before the statins, but the cost, this anti-PCSK9 highly costly drug, but they are very highly effective anti-hyperlipidemic agents. Now, this prevents the low density lipoprotein LDL receptor degradation and thus producing a significant reduction of the LDL low density lipoprotein cholesterol level in the bloodstream and decrease the risk of cardiovascular events. Now, atorvastatin, a known statin, is one of the most widely used prescribed drug and statin in the world, and this is a HMG CoA reductase, hydroxymethyl glutaryl coenzyme A reductase inhibitor that is prescribed to prevent the adverse cardiovascular events and to lower the blood cholesterol level and the LDL cholesterol level, total blood cholesterol and LDL particularly. Now, the receptor, toll-like receptor, they play a crucial role in the innate immunity system by recognizing the pathogen-associated molecular pattern derived from the various microbes. Now, TLR signal through the recruitment of specific adapter molecules, leading to activation of the transcription factor, nuclear factor kappa B, and interferon regulatory factor, which dictate the outcome of innate immune responses. So during the past decade, precise mechanism underlying TLR signaling have been clarified by various approaches involving genetic, biochemical, structural, cell biological, and bioinformatics studies. One of the PhD candidate, Arya Priyanka, in her PhD thesis, she performed protein-protein docking study of this anti-PCSK9 monoclonal antibody at the toll-like receptor 2 protein receptor, TLR2 protein receptor catalytic ligand binding site. Okay, and this ID of this data protein data bank 3A7B, the docking and the site map of anti-PCSK9 monoclonal antibody were performed using the software Maestro version 10.6 implemented from Schrodinger USA software suite. The ligand was cached in 3D format using built panel and was prepared for docking using LigPrep application. The protein for docking study was taken from protein data bank of TLR2 and prepared by removing the solvents, adding hydrogen and further energy minimizing using the protein preparation wizard. Now, grids for this molecular docking were generated with standard ligand atorvastatin. Anti-PCSK9 was docked using protein-protein docking mode with up to 10 poses saved per molecule. This is the diagram showing the binding mode of anti-PCSK9 shown in cyano color and in the TLR2, that is shown in green, active site in the ribbon structure, green and the cyano color. Now, the binding site of atorvastatin, this is brown, is shown in the TLR2 protein active site, and important residues are highlighted with the gray sticks. The docking analysis of atorvastatin against TLR2 showed the interaction in the catalytic domain, that is phenylalanine 266 and tyrosine 326. Herein, we reported the binding pose of NTPCS canine monoclonal antibody and also compared the standard atorvastatin, which also binded with the TLR2. Now, sitemap study was performed. It was found that NTPCS canine monoclonal antibody interact with a similar fashion as that of the atorvastatin with the TLR2 protein receptor through active binding residues, which were present in the active site of the NTPCS canine. Two. Now, second study, it is the in silico study, protein, another of the protein-protein docking study of the NTPCS canine monoclonal antibody and the standard ligand atorvastatin binding with NF-kappa P50, protein 50. Now, this NF-kappa is a family of highly conserved transcription factors that regulate the many more important cellular behavior. Many important cellular behavior in particular is involved in the inflammatory responses, cellular growth and cell death, programmed cell death, apoptosis. So for a better understanding of the binding mode of NTPCSK9 monoclonal antibody at the molecular level, we carried out molecular docking and protein-protein docking of NTPCSK9 at the NF-kappa P50 protein receptor catalytic ligand binding site. And this is the idea of this. The docking and site map of NTPCS can be performed using this software. The ligand was sketched in 3D format using build panel and was prepared for docking using LigPrep application. The protein for docking study was taken from protein data bank of NF-kappa, and this was the ID, and it was prepared by removing the solvent, adding hydrogen and further energy minimization using protein preparation wizard. Now, grids for molecular docking was generated with standard ligand, atorvastatin, and NTPCSK9 monoclonal antibody was docked using protein-protein docking mode with up to 10 poses saved per molecule. So this was the protein-protein docking study or docking of the NTPCSK9 and the standard ligand atorvastatin binding with the NF-kappa P50. Now the binding mode of NTPCSK9 is shown in the violet color. Now on the NF-kappa P50, active site and important residues are highlighted with the gray stick. And second slide B shows the binding mode of atorvastatin. Brown is shown in the NF-kappa P50 protein active site and the important residues are highlighted with the gray stick. Now atorvastatin interact with the NF-kappa P50 protein receptor through the active binding site residues, and these are the lysine and the glutamine and the leucine and the arginine and the histidine 181, similarly, which was present in the active site of the NTPCSK9 monoclonal antibody. So the docking study revealed that NTPCSK9 monoclonal antibody interact similarly as atorvastatin with the NF-kappa P50 protein receptor through the active binding site. Now, in nutshell, we can say the protein-protein molecular docking of the NTPCSK9 and the atorvastatin against TLR2 and as well as the NF-kappa P50. So you can see in the atorvastatin and NTPCSK9 targets TLR2. So these residues, amino acid residue, same here. These two of pH 2.266 and tyrosine 326 here are similar. Similarly, atorvastatin NF-kappa, few of them, lysine 279, using this, they are similar, except this one. Now, second is, this was the protein-protein binding docking. Now, protein receptor ligand docking also. Second, that is molecular docking of amblin and orlistat against TLR4, toll-like receptor 4 type. So amblin, this was done by another PhD student. It is the major bioactive constituent of the Amblyrhynchus family, belonging to the family Myrcinaceae, and it has got wide spectrum of activity, anti-tumor, antioxidant, analgesic and anti-fertility and wound healing. There's a number of effects, but it has got anti-obesity potential. Now, orlistat, which is a known or standard anti-obesity agent, it works by inhibiting the lipases, gastric and pancreatic. So this enzyme lipase breaks down triglyceride in the intestine. So orlistat is currently a drug which is used to treat obesity. So another PhD student performed molecular docking of the amblin drug against the TLR4 protein receptor. The molecular docking was performed using TLR4 protein receptor and carried out again on the same Maestro version 9.6 USA software. The protein for docking study was taken from protein data bank. And the ligand was sketched in 3D format. And using the build panel. And was prepared for docking using lift prep application and prepared by removing solvent as was in the previous case. Now, grids for this for standard ligand was compared, generated with standard ligand orlistat, and amblin was docked using glide extra precision XP mode with up to 3 poses saved per molecule. Now, this is the molecular docking of amblin and orlistat against TLR4. So binding mode of amblin is brown in color, is shown in the TLR4 active site, and important residues are highlighted with the gray stick. Now second figure shows the binding mode of orlistat, standard anti-obesity agent, brown in color, shown in the TLR4 protein active site, and important residues are highlighted with the gray stick. Now the docking studies reveal a common binding orientation of the amblin in the catalytic binding pocket of TLR4 protein, TLR4 protein, toll-like 4 receptor, 4 protein receptor. Herein we report the binding pose of amblin and also compare with the standard orlistat, which is bonded with the TLR4 protein. So amblin showed binding interaction with backbone of the TLR4 protein receptor with the binding residues. These are the binding residues. Amblin showed superimposition with the orlistat and also showed same interaction in catalytic domain of the TLR4 protein receptor. So amblin showed better docking score than the standard ligand. And amblin showed 3 hydrogen bond and orlistat showed only 1 hydrogen bond. Then there was a molecular docking of amblin and orlistat against TNF-alpha, tissue necrosis factor alpha, which is again an inflammatory cytokine which is produced by the macrophages during the acute inflammation and is responsible for a wide range of signaling events within the cell and which leads to necrosis or the apoptosis. So molecular docking was performed against the TNF-alpha protein receptor and carried out on this software. So protein for docking study was taken from the protein data bank. And the ligand was sketched in 3D format using build panel and was prepared for docking using lick prep application and prepared by removing solvent, adding hydrogen and further energy minimization using protein preparation measure. So next diagram shows the results of the molecular docking of amblin and orlistat. So the binding mode of the amblin, brown in color, is shown in the TNF alpha active site, and important residues are highlighted with the gray stick. And second B diagram, the binding mode of orlistat, brown in color, is shown in the TNF alpha protein and active site, and important residues are highlighted with the gray stick. And the grids for the molecular docking were generated using standard ligand An embellin was dogged using glide extra precision mode with up to 3 poses saved per mile. Then, next slide. So embellin showed binding interaction with backbone of TNF alpha protein receptor with the binding residue tyrosine 119 and the lysine 98. Our research shows only interaction with the binding residue tyrosine 119. Embellin showed docking score minus 2.99 and standard orlistat minus 2.676. So embellin showed two hydrogen bonds, virality store shows one hydrogen bond. Now, in silico analysis, nowadays in silico methodologies have become a crucial part of the drug discovery process because they can impart the entire drug development trajectory, identifying and discovering new potential drugs with significant reduction to cost and time. Further, computer-aided design, drug design approaches are important for reducing the experimental use of the animals for in vivo testing and for aiding the design of the safer drugs and for repositioning known drugs, assisting medicinal chemists at each step during the drug discovery process. So on one hand, conventional methods for drug discovery involve the costly random screening of the synthesized compound or natural products. On the other hand, computational procedure can be very multifarious, requiring interdisciplinary studies and the application of computer science to rationally design effective and commercially feasible drugs. Now, computational methods have been developed and applied to pharmacology thesis, hypothesis development, and the testing. So these in silico methods, what are these? Databases, quantitative structure activity relationship, pharmacophores, homology models, and other molecular modeling approaches, machine learning, data mining, network analysis tools, and data analysis tools that use a computer. So in silico methods are primarily used alongside the generation of in vitro data, both to create the model and to test. So such models have seen frequent use in the discovery and optimization of the novel molecules with affinity to a target, the clarification of absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion, ADME, and the toxicity properties, as well as physicochemical characterization. So it is the use of in silico gene mining strategies provide an excellent framework for the initial identification of the key genes and the gene cluster whose expression is altered in diseased tissue. And data which is generated in these investigations provide a starting point for the investigations aimed at delineating the molecular basis of the disease. So, biomedical researchers, they are equipped with both the map of the genome and understanding of how gene expression events contribute to health and disease. However, the in silico methodologies analyze the different gene expression, such as serial analysis of gene expression and digital differential display. And these are a few of the references for this talk. And thank you to all of you. This was actually all the computational and the chemistry part of the talk. I was also not aware of many of these things, but since it is a chemistry talk, so I found out few of the drug designing methods from various sources. And few of the studies were done in our lab, in silico studies. Based on that, we derived out our conclusion that in silico analysis. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you very much, madam, for knowledgeable sessions. Now the time is query sessions. From the participant side, I am requested to audience, if you have any queries, please write in the chat box. Further, I am requested to Dr. Sumanlata Madam, Associate Professor, Department of Pharmaceutical Chemistry, for some of the sessions and give the vote of thanks to the speaker.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thanks for the thanks, Dr. Uma Bhandari, madam. I am very thankful to you for informative and knowledgeable lecture on topic in silico analysis, a computational technique in target identification in the era of personalized medicine and pattern-informed cost-effective public health outcome, a system of personalized medicine that is based on molecular state have become fundamental in drug discovery to build a system. The molecular characterization of disease is necessary, while in environmental influence and the gut micromass need to also considered. The same time, regulatory requirement of safety are increasing. Computer-aided drug design represent computational method and resources that are used to facilitate the design and discovery of new therapeutic solutions. In silico is the expression used to mean performed on computer or by computer simulation. In silico technique significantly contribute to early drug discovery and are important in target and lead discovery. So ma'am, thank you very much for your valuable contribution and also adding the knowledge and knowledge about regarding CAD and accepting our request. Thank you very much.
Now I would like to present your certificate on behalf of organizing committee. Copy of this certificate shortly sent by the. Thank you very much, madam. Four sessions on this STTP programs going to close. I am requested to all participants, please submit morning and afternoon today sessions feedback form after the receiving of link. Tomorrow day fifth sessions link will be the sent by the email and WhatsApp group. Please join us more time on time. Thank you very much to all. Have a nice day. Thank you.